Okay, please welcome Ralf Kreinen, who will be giving us an introduction on the process towards the formal verification of maintainer scripts.
Okay, thanks, Jonathan. Okay. So I would like to present to you a program which we recently started. I would start by explaining to you what actually this title means, tell you a short story about how this program came into living. I will tell you a little bit about what we intend to do during the next years. And finally, I have a few questions for you. In fact, you might also have some questions for me, but I also have questions for you. So, okay, so let's start with the title. Towards the formal verification of maintainer scripts. So the first important part in the title is the word towards. And I start with a disclaimer. So we just began, well, officially we began last year, but we mostly began work during the spring of this year. So this is very new. There's nothing to show yet, so I don't have any results yet. I don't have any tools yet. I hope to have something in a few years, but we are just beginning and I'm just talking about what we are going to do in the future. So this is a collaborative research project over probably over 5 years. And I'm just telling you about my plans for the moment, and hopefully I will be able to tell you more concrete stuff in the DevConfs to come in the future. Okay, maintainer scripts. In case you don't know what it is, probably most of you will know what it is. So in a binary package, in a dev package. So this is from the policy. You have basically two things. You have a tuple of files which are just installed on your file system when you install the package. And then you have a second set of files which are confusingly called by the policy control information files. And among these so-called control information files, you have the maintainer scripts, which will be executed during installation, removal, and upgrading of your packages. And among these maintainer scripts, you have four different kinds of maintainer scripts, which might be included in your package. It's not necessary. They might be missing, but many of the packages are, in fact, including at least some of these maintainer scripts. So you have pre-inst, post-inst, pre-RM, and post-RM. And roughly, it means that, well, you have in your binary package, you have the files which will be placed on your file system when you install your package. The pre-inst will be executed before you start placing these files on your file system, before you start unpacking the tarball. The post-inst will be executed after you have installed the files on your file system. And usually what this script is doing is configuring your package. And then you have to reverse, here is the opposite. So the pre-RM will be executed before you will remove files from your file system, and post-RM will be executed after you have removed the files from your file system. Okay, and this is just a first approximation. This is what's happening when you freshly install a package on your system, or when you remove it from your system. It gets a little bit more complicated when you do an upgrade, because when you do an upgrade, you run a combination of maintainer scripts coming from the old version of the package and of maintainer scripts coming from the new version of the package. And it even gets more involved when you look at failure conditions. So it might happen that during installation of a package, one of these guys here fails. And then when you look it up in the policy, chapter 6, you have a detailed description of what's going to happen. And in fact, if that happens, then some of these scripts are executed with a special argument, something like abort install, which tries to roll back the failed attempt to install the package with the goal of undoing everything which has been done during the failed attempt to install your package. Now, the third part of the title is verification, and what do I mean by that? Well, I even called it formal verification to make it more clear what I mean. So it's about proofs of correctness of programs. And this is something which is a very strong thing to have if you succeed in constructing such a proof. In order to do that, in order to be able to construct a proof of correctness of a script of a program in general, you need several things. Well, the first thing that you need is, of course, you need a formal model, a very precise definition of what it means to execute your program. And that would include both an exact description of the execution model of your programming language, in this case of the script language, on the one hand, and on the other hand, you also need a very precise description of what the data is that you are going to manipulate by your program. And in our case, the data that you manipulate by executing such a script is, of course, the state of your current installation of the machine, which includes the file system and even more. So this, of course, has to be described precisely in a formal way in order to be able to do some proofs about it. Okay, that's the first thing. And the second thing is, of course, well, if you want to prove something, you must know what exactly you want to prove. So in that case, this means that what you need is a precise statement of what the program is supposed to do. And there are several ways of doing that, and the normal way how you would express such a statement of correctness of your program, which you would like to prove after having stated it, is something which is expressed by a precondition and a postcondition. That would mean the precondition and the postcondition would express, maybe in our case, properties of the file system or in general states of your system, and such a assertion would express that whenever you are in an initial state which satisfies a given precondition. Let's imagine the precondition would express your file system is conformant to the file hierarchy standard, for instance, something like that. So whenever you are in some arbitrary initial condition which satisfies your precondition and you execute your program, then at the end you arrive in a new state which again satisfies the postcondition, so the terminal condition which you also have expressed in your correctness statement. To be precise, there is a subtle difference in whether you actually require that your program terminates or not. Okay, but this goes a little bit too much into details about program verification. In any way, in our case, maintainer scripts usually are expected to terminate quite quickly. Okay, so you have an initial condition and a terminal condition which you would like to have verified for your program. And this is not testing. So this is important to understand. So what you get by formal proof is something which is much more than testing. In fact, what you get from a formal proof is a certification that whenever you are in any arbitrary situation which satisfies your precondition, then you are guaranteed to obtain at the end something which satisfies your postcondition. You won't get this with testing, well, at least not easily, because with testing, all you can test are particular test cases which you have designed, and all you get by testing is that, well, when you run this particular test in a particular initial starting configuration, then your program will pass the test or will not pass the test. So testing always gives you only a correctness assertion for one particular situation, and it's not a general assertion for any arbitrary condition, starting condition, which you might have in the beginning. However, there still is a connection between formal verification on the one hand and testing on the other hand, and I will come back to that a little bit later. About the properties, well, I have stated something like precondition, execution, postcondition. In fact, when we look at maintainer scripts, it's even much more interesting the kind of conditions that you would like to verify about the scripts, and I will come also to this in a few slides. But let's first tell me a little story. So that's a story about a little package called a CMI CREP, and this package received a bug report, in fact, a critical bug report. And in the bug report, it was written, well, it started like that. The Emacs install script is overzealous. It inappropriately attempts to compile all .el files in some directory inside Lisp. Well, that's already not good, but it's not a catastrophe either for now. But then it continues and compounds the problem by removing .el files which may belong to different packages. And this, of course, is very, very bad, and this absolutely should not happen. Critical severity was certainly appropriate for this kind of problem, and in fact, in this case, the reporter of the bug report was still quite kind in formulating it in these words and not being more bold about what was happening here. Okay, so now let's try to understand how this could happen. First, I should explain what's going on with this Emacs stuff. So you probably know that you have for Emacs stuff, you have programming languages for Emacs macros, which is EL, Emacs Lisp, and Emacs Lisp can be compiled to Emacs bytecode. However, we have in general, we have different versions of Emacs in Debian. Well, for the moment, we only have an old Emacs 21 and we have Emacs 24, but at different points in time, we had different versions of Emacs like Emacs 22, 23, 24 in the archive, and all of these had different bytecode formats. Now, Debian decided that we want to install, when we install Emacs stuff with a package, that Emacs Lisp files are compiled to bytecode. However, since we have different formats of bytecode for different versions of Emacs, this might mean that we should include in the binary package compiled bytecode for all the different Emacs versions. And it was decided to do it not that way, but to compile Emacs code while you are installing the package. So this is going what's happening with this Emacs stuff. So if you install a package which contains Emacs Lisp code, then during installation of the package, in fact, this code is compiled for all the versions of Emacs that you have currently installed on your system into bytecode for that particular version of Emacs. Okay, and this is roughly how it works. Well, to be more precise, in fact, it's not really part of the post script. It's part of the Emacs install script, which in that case is included in your package. But this Emacs install script is called on by your post inst script. So the post inst script will call a script which belongs to the Emacs common infrastructure. And that script, in turn, will call the Emacs install script particular to your package. So this is only indirectly part of the post inst script. Anyway, this is what's happening here. Basically, for all the flavors, the versions of Emacs which you have installed on your machine, in fact, you would compile your Elisp stuff to bytecode and place it in a directory which is proper to this flavor of Emacs, and it will do that for all the versions of Emacs installed on your machine. And of course, something similar is happening when you are installing a new version of Emacs. Then also, you would recompile all the packages which you have which contain Elisp code and which you have installed. So this is what's happening on installation of the package in the post inst, and on the when you remove the package, of course you do the reverse and you remove all the bytecode of the packages. Now when you come back now to our small CMI grab package, this is what was in the Emacs install script initially in an earlier version. So there was a variable defined which contained which was a template for the directory which was going to hold the compiled bytecode, and then this directory would be created, and then there was some invocation of Emacs which would compile the stuff and place the compiled bytecode into these directories which had been created here and which initially were proper to this package. This was at installation. And at removal, of course, you had reverse. So you would define the same variable and then remove the ELC, the compiled bytecode files. And finally, you would remove the directory. And it was written in this way because this would fail if the directory contains more than ELC stuff. And this was, of course, on purpose, because if that happened, then something was wrong. And in that case, of course, the script should fail and must fail. Okay. However, at some point, the maintainer decided, well, in fact, there was only one file, one Emacs, that's a difficult word, Emacs Lisp file in this package. So he decided that it was overkill to create a directory only for this package. So he decided that was too much, and he wanted to change it, and he changed it. But he got it wrong, because what he did is, well, he just removed the package, dollar package stuff here. Well, he kept that makedir, -p, doesn't matter. And then he created on installation of the package still the bytecode files in this directory now, one level up. And when you remove, what he did, well, he kept this definition of the variable. And he removed now, he's also kept this line, which removed all the ELC files in this directory. And this is, of course, what went wrong, and this explains what happened and why the package maintainer received this this critical bug report. Okay, so what we can learn from this little story is, well, what the maintainer did was really stupid, because such a mistake, he should not make such a mistake, and frankly, there is no excuse for the maintainer to have overlooked this this error in the modification which he did in the maintainer scripts. And I'm allowed to say this here in public because I was myself the maintainer, of course, of this package who did this stupid mistake. Well, but then when you make a mistake, you can learn from it. And this made me thinking, so maybe this is something where we can improve our process that we have in Debian and where we can try to analyze and find these kind of errors and detect them in the archive. What's also interesting about this is that, well, testing, you can ask yourself whether testing would have detected this error. And, well, it depends. Because if you do testing which is too naive, then you would not detect it. Too naive means if you would take a change root, a minimal change root, where the site lisp directory where bytecode is placed is non-populated. In that case, when you test installation and removal, everything works fine. Because you just install your package in an empty directory, and then you remove it, and then you come back to the initial configuration. So this test case would not detect this kind of error. There are other test cases which would detect it. So if you would test installation and removal of the package in a situation where you have already populated your system with some other Emacs stuff, then you would detect it, because in that case, some files not owned by this package would be removed. Okay, so testing not always detects easily this kind of errors. And what we would like to have, and this is so now the scope of this research program, is that we would like to do to obtain an assertion that in fact maintainer scripts do not do any of this nasty stuff in whatever initial situation you install, you execute these maintainer scripts, and in which situation you install and remove packages. Now you have seen also on this example that what we had here is a stupid mistake, an easy mistake. It's a mistake of the kind, if you look at it, or if I show it to you, you say, well, of course, it's obvious. How could I miss that? And what you can get with formal methods and automatic tools are often analyses which can find these kind of stupid mistakes. But this might seem trivial to do, but you must not forget that we have 50,000 packages now in main. Most of them contain maintainer scripts, and no one is able to look and audit all the maintainer scripts that we have in the binary packages. So what we need is really automatic tools which are able to do this kind of quality assurance, analyze, run over all the archive, and find all this kind of stupid mistakes which might exist in the maintainer scripts and maybe which are only triggered in particular situations. Okay, this is another slide. This is a slide which I usually use when I talk to people who do not know Debian. So what is at the root of the problem, why we have this kind of problems, is that we have shared infrastructure between packages. So things would be very, very easy if we had isolated silos where each of the packages would install its own stuff without touching any of the stuff in the other packages. But that's not possible. Debian does not work that way, and this is the case on various levels. It's also the case with shared libraries. It's also the case with the file system. So in general, we need infrastructure which is shared. And we must have packages which, for instance, install add-ons, plugins, or however you would like to call it, which interact with other packages and which share parts of its infrastructure. Think of tech, Emacs in our case, and there are some others. And this makes the problem, of course, much more difficult and interesting. If we hadn't that, there are, in fact, some trivial packaging systems which don't have it. But with these packaging systems, you cannot package anything interesting. In fact, you just can package toys. All right. Now, I have already talked for 20 minutes. So what we are going to do is, well, formal verification and, again, a disclaimer. The disclaimer is, well, in principle, it's impossible to do. It's impossible, it's much too hard to do it perfectly, and you can never expect that we will develop a tool, even 5 and even 10 or 15 years, for which you can fill in all the maintainer scripts, and then you run it, you push on a button, and then you obtain just a list of all errors, or you obtain a certificate which says this script is perfect and it contains no error at all. And there are two reasons for that. The first reason is that the execution model is much too rich. It contains a lot of stuff. It contains already all the programming language, the scripting language, and it contains also, it should to be perfect, also contain a complete description of the state of a Unix operating system, which is of course quite impossible to do. That's the one reason. And the second reason is that even if you restrict yourself to a very, very simple programming model, say while programs, while ifs and else which manipulate integers, is already what we call in theory undecidable. That is, it is not possible in principle to write a program which gives you in a finite time an assertion of correctness of a program. This is similar to the halting problem, if you ever have heard of that. The basic reason is, well, if such a program existed, you could apply it to itself, and from that you could derive a contradiction. So it's even in theory, it's not possible to do it. However, the fact that it's not possible in theory should not stop us from trying to do it anyway. Okay, well, this might sound strange, but in fact, when you have a theoretical result that something is impossible or is too expensive to do, then often this does not hold in practice, because in practice, the worst situation often does not occur or only occurs in very particular situations. So often you can still do something which gives you a result in a particular situation. It's also interesting to compare this to what we did in the EDOS and Mancusi projects, previous projects of ours, where we analyzed package dependencies, like conflicts and so on. You probably have heard of that. That was a different difficulty, because in that case, we knew already in the beginning that it's possible to do in principle, at least in principle. But for these projects, the challenge was scale, to find a solution which gives you a result in a reasonable time. And we managed to do that. But in this case, it's much more difficult, because in principle, there's even a principle problem of finding a way to solve the problem at all. Okay, so now I have to speed up. So let me just say about maintainer scripts. So most of them, are POSIX shell scripts. In fact, you may have other stuff than POSIX shell scripts in maintainer scripts. You might even have ELF executables. There's at least one in the archive, but in most cases, they are POSIX shell scripts with some extensions mandated by policy, which I have written here. So echo and echo minus n test when it's in built-in must support and or. You have local scopes and stuff like that. But basically, it's POSIX shell. Now, how do we look at these POSIX shell scripts? Well, the good thing is that maintainer scripts typically are quite easy, quite small programs. And we look at them just as a transformation of the file system tree, which means we ignore everything else. We ignore starting of services, stopping of services, stuff like that. So we just look at the file system tree that you have at the beginning of the execution of your script and what you have at the end of the script. So from a mathematical point of view, this is already much more treatable. You have a tree which you transform in a different tree. But when I say that, this is, of course, an abstraction. First of all, you know all that the file system structure is not really a tree, because you have hard links to regular files. You also have symbolic links, stuff like that. And it also means that we ignore, of course, anything else which might be going on. Okay, so let's look at scripts. And the first problem with scripts is that when you look at the POSIX standard, the POSIX standard is not the most, is not the nicest text to read in your leisure time. And the script shell language is not the best designed programming language in existence. And this concerns both syntax and semantics. So there are several things in it which are very, very hard to analyze formally. And this usually is an indication that it's only quite hard to program correctly shell scripts, because when you have a problem in theory, it usually indicates that there also is a problem in practice. However, what is good is that we don't have the full complexity usually of POSIX shell in what we find in maintainer scripts. In particular, recursive functions, which are allowed, of course, in theory do not occur in maintainer scripts. Exit codes, so maintainer scripts only look at whether it's zero or not, so a fatal error or not. Loops are only used in quite restricted ways, mostly for loops, which are quite easy to handle. Well, they are easier to handle than general while loops. And the while loops we have in maintainer scripts are often, in fact, hidden for loops, because it's quite often the construction where you have something which you pipe into while read. So in practice, it behaves more like a for loop. Luckily, we have the big dpkg lock, which means that it's not possible to install several packages in parallel. So we don't have to care about problems between of concurrency in execution of scripts. And there are some other simplifications which we can use. Okay, so I have to speed up a lot, I think. So what we are going to do is, well, we will not work directly on shell scripts, on POSIX shell. In fact, we will use a domain-specific language, which we called Kuli, which is also the name of our project, in which we will rewrite the scripts we are going, well, at the beginning, we will rewrite by hand the scripts into this language before feeding them to the formal tools. At the end, what we want to have is, we want to have a compiler which takes a shell script and translates it in our language, which is more sane and much more tweetable for formal tools. This language is we are just doing that at the moment. This language is still quite close to the execution model of POSIX shell, in particular concerning control flow and the usage of exit codes. So it's probably not the right language that one might use if you want to replace shell as a programming language for maintainer scripts. But it's something which is very useful for us when we want to do verification. Okay, now probably the most interesting part is, what are the properties of the maintainer scripts that we want to analyze and to verify? Well, first of all, you have properties which you can express with this precondition, execution, postcondition paradigm. And what you can expect here is something like, well, you might want to have that when you have a maintainer script and when you execute it in a reasonable initial condition, then you don't get an error. It executes without an error. The difficulty in this is, of course, what does it mean reasonable? Okay, frankly, I have no precise idea at the moment what reasonable means. It should mean, it's conform to the file hierarchy standard. It fulfills everything which we have written in the policy, possibly something else. So this is something which one possibly might want to have, but it's for the moment not exactly clear what it means. We might also have properties like what we call an invariant in verification. That is, when you have some condition at the beginning, you also have the same condition at the end. Here, for instance, you could have properties like compliance to FHS or to the Debian policy. More interesting are relations between scripts. And this is also interesting from a theoretical point of view for the people who are working on verification, because to my knowledge, no one has ever yet tried to verify these kind of properties of scripts. What do we have here? So first of all, we have this strange symbol. This is functional composition. So it means we have a first script. And as I told you, we look at it as a function, transforming one tree into another tree. So this means first executing an I, something I call I, and then executing R, should be the same as the identity. Or in other words, the R would just be the inverse of this of the I. Where is this interesting for us? Well, you might expect that when you install, in general, when you install a package on your machine and then you deinstall it, then you come back to the same situation that you had in the beginning. Now, if you expand this into scripts, it would read like this. And here I use this notion from functional programming, which means piping. So if you have an initial file system F, and you would pipe this into the, so this is what's happening, the first three steps is what's happening at the installation phase. First, you run your pre-install script, then you unpack your stuff, you run the post-install script, and then you remove the package. So you run your pre-RM, you remove stuff, and you run the post-RM, and then at the end, you should obtain the same F than you had in the beginning. And this is something which you would expect to hold for any file system F, for any. And that's important, and This is really an important word here. That's why it's written here in red. Besides that, it's not really true what I've written. Well, when you remove stuff, then this holds up to log files and configuration files, as it is written in the policy. However, when you purge packages, this, of course, should hold. And now when you think again of our small CMI grep package, this, in fact, did not hold. In fact, if you would choose for F here a file system where the sitelisp directory is not populated, then you have this equality. However, when you choose for F a file system where you have already some Emacs lisp stuff installed, then it doesn't hold. So it's very important that you have here this for any file system F and that you try really to prove something which holds for any initial situation. Okay, that's interesting. I'm not sure whether this is sufficient. Maybe we want something like this. So here I also have an S, and this strange symbol, it means also for any S. So this would mean that if you take any other maintainer script, which comes, for instance, from installing other stuff, then we might also expect that, well, we install a package, then we install some other stuff. This would trigger execution of S. Then we remove our package. If you do that, then we would expect that this has exactly the same effect as only installing the other stuff without installing our package before and removing it afterwards. This seems to be a different condition, a different property to what I've shown to you before. I'm not completely sure, but it looks a little bit different. And this is, in any way, it's something which certainly we would like to have for maintainer scripts. Commutation. Commutation of scripts, which means it doesn't matter in which order you execute them. This might also be interesting. You might know that post inst scripts are executed in the order which is compliant with dependency of packages, which of course poses a problem when you have dependency loops between packages, because in this case it's no longer deterministic in which order scripts are executed. So if you know that the order in which you execute scripts does not matter, then in fact you know that in fact you can execute them in any order. So it would be important for installation of packages with dependency loops on the one hand, and I think there are also some other cases where you have reordering of installation scripts. I think that Embedian is doing it also for efficiency reasons and executes scripts sometimes in a different order. So this is also something which is interesting to do. And then we have item potency. So that's my favorite. So Debian policy 6.1 says, in fact, maintainer scripts must be item potent. Now, when I talk to a mathematician, he says, well, that's nice. I know what it means. Item potency is when I execute a function twice, it gives you the same result as executing it only once. However, this is not what Debian policy means when it talks about item potency. Debian policy says, well, if the first call failed or aborted halfway through for some reason, the second call should merely do the things that were left undone the first time, if any, and exit with the success status if everything is okay. So that's much more involved, because it talks about the fact that the first script might fail, and then you execute again the script, and for any possible way how the first execution of the script failed, still the second execution should at the end give you the same exact effect as only executing it once with success. And frankly, so this is quite interesting, but I don't know what it means. Because what does it mean that you might have that your package installation fails, your script fails the first time, and in the same situation, exactly the same situation, it succeeds. It doesn't make any sense. Well, it might happen that you plug in one heater too many and power fails and you shut your system off by an external reason. That would be an explanation. But I think what policy here means is something more, because you might have, for instance, that you install, you make a first attempt to execute it. You make a first attempt to execute it, and then maybe, for instance, you have a reason for failure which is internal to the system, like your file system is full. Then you would remove stuff, and then you would execute the script again, and then it would succeed. But this is a different property, because it means that between the first execution of the script and the second execution of the script, you have some action. and I don't know really what these actions are which you could execute between the first and the second invocation of the script. Yes, you have a remark.
This property as that the maintainer script should be a series of atomic idempotent steps, and every step is idempotent in your first meaning. So you just interpret it this way, then it'll be idempotent in the second sense.
Yeah, but it's not atomic. Yeah? Scripts are not atomic. So if a script fails halfway through,
it's not atomic on itself. But of course, it's not atomic because it can fail in the middle. But this second Debian definition means that it consists of series of atomic steps. Every step can either succeed or fail, and every step is important in the first meaning of yours. That's basically. And if it fails in the middle, you run it again. Then every step is important.
Well, this is only true when the different steps are independent of each other. Only if that is the case, you can conclude from the fact that the individual steps are idempotent, that the scripts are also idempotent. However, if the different steps that your script takes depend on the order in which you execute them, that is, you have different steps which depend on each other, then you don't get idempotency of the script itself from idempotency of the atomic steps. Not necessarily. Okay. So maybe we can discuss this later if you're interested. But anyway, I find it quite interesting to look at these properties and try to understand what they mean. Let me just say, even if I don't have much time, it's important for me to say, when I say there's something I do not understand in policy, let me say one of the best points in Debian is that we have policy. And if you do any kind of work in this direction of analyzing what we have in the package, what we have in these scripts, policy is absolutely priceless. So without policy, we could never do anything like that. And I think there is no other software distribution which has anything which is even close to what we have here in Debian policy and in the description of what's supposed to happen in packages. So it's very important to have this, and without it we would be completely lost. Okay, now I don't have time to look into the particular techniques, unfortunately, which we are intending to apply. Let me just say that there are two different kinds of techniques which we are planning to apply to this problem. One of them is using so-called deductive verification, and for this we have tools which already exist in Debian. Some of them are free software. We have a platform for so-called deductive verification, which is DFSG-free. It's called Y3. We have it in Debian, and it uses so-called SAT solvers or SMT solvers, which are very important to do the last step in this verification attempt. These solvers, even if I don't have the time to explain what they do, these solvers have become very, very strong over the last decade, and people in verification talk about the SMT revolution, so it's probably the most significant advancement in formal methods that we had over the last decade. Some of them are free, not all of them are free. Some of them are free, and some of them, we have them already in Debian, and we are intending to use them. So in the end, the project will look a little bit like this. So we will have maintainer scripts, shell scripts. Some of them, not all of them, we will be able to compile in our domain-specific language. Then we will have as a front end a verification platform, which might be interactive, but can also be used in a batch format, which knows about file systems and stuff, and the execution model of the programming language, which will understand the programming constructs, generate from these proof obligations, and pass them on to specialized solvers. So this is a research project over 4 to 5 years. So we have 4 years for the moment, with the possibility of having 1 year more. We have sponsoring, so thanks to our sponsor at this occasion, which is the National French Research Funding Agency. which gives us quite some money to hire PhD students and postdocs and gives us travel money, for instance, for me to come to DepConf here and talk about this stuff. We have three academic sites which are specialists on these various aspects of this project, and we who will work together, something like 12 to 15 people on this project. Now, what are the questions? The questions that I have to you is, so I've shown you a little story about one of my packages, and if you have any interesting stories about faulty maintainer scripts, and I'm sure some of you have, so I certainly would like to hear about them. The properties, so I found some properties which are interesting to verify and important for the project. So maybe there are some others that you can think of that are interesting, so I would like to hear about them. And finally, maintainer scripts. What's your stand on maintainer scripts? I know there are some people, Niels unfortunately isn't here. So I know Niels, he wants to get rid of maintainer scripts as far as possible. Oh, you're here, okay. Very good. So should we get rid of them? Can we get rid of them? Can we improve the situation of maintainer scripts? So what do you think about maintainer scripts? Okay, thanks for your attention.
Out of time for questions, but maybe we can sneak one or two in anyway. So, any comments or questions?
So you said you started last year. It's this is currently not even working, or do you have a prototype that does something?
No. There's no prototype yet. There's nothing yet. So we officially started last year. And well, most of the people who are working on this are like me, teachers. So we don't have so much time to do our research. And we hired a student, a PhD student, who is going to do a good part of this work. And he arrived a few months ago. So we are just starting. We are now currently defining this DSL. So this more abstract programming language. We don't have a concrete syntax yet. We only have an abstract syntax. We are defining its semantics. We are thinking already about verification. So there are no tools yet. Nothing is working for the moment.
Well, of course, there's always time to adding complexity to your ideas. While you were describing the view you have on file systems, how you will treat it as a tree, even if it's not.
Yeah.
So you could do, although it's much less, much more error prone, I think, but you could also look at the process tree. Say whatever happens inside the process group, which of course time plays a very important factor there, but you said that you're explicitly not counting process spawning or killing.
Yep.
So I think it will be a very interesting addition.
Yeah, okay. So this would add a lot of complexity when you have to consider concurrent execution of stuff. On the one hand, on the other hand, concurrency is of course one of the places where formal tools can really add a lot and give you a lot of benefit. Because when you have interleaving of processes, then there are so many possibilities that really it's impossible to do it. Well, it's very, very hard to do it by hand in your own brain. And this is where formal tools can really help you to analyze the situation. However, with concurrency, stuff becomes much, much more complicated. And we would really like to abstract away from this and just look at sequential transformations of trees.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.